Apostle Paul wrote to the pastor, "Pastor, command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share." 1 Timothy 6:18. So that's what I'm going to do today. God's blessings to you. I'll tell you a story. A minister and a soap maker went for a walk one day in the park, and they were, you know, kind of walking around and studying people, pointing them out here and there. And about an hour or so into this walk, the soap maker turns to the minister and says, "Preacher, what good's religion? Look at all the trouble and all the misery in this world. There is so much sin and there is so much sadness. And even after so many years of, you know, teaching and preaching about goodness and truth and peace and grace, if Christianity is so great, and why should this be?" The pastor said nothing. They kept walking until the minister happened to see a child playing in the dirt. And he said, "Soap maker, what good soap? Just look at that kid over there. You say soap makes you clean, but all the soap in the world, over all many years of washing and scrubbing, that boy's still filthy. If soap is so great, then why should this be?" Soap maker protested and exclaimed to the minister, "But preacher, soap cannot do anything unless it is used." And with a nod, the pastor said, "Exactly. Like soap, faith requires action." You heard that unmistakably from God's word this morning. The text clearly indicates that faith has a doing component to it. Faith without works is dead. And perhaps that's a tough one for us Lutherans to take. If you grew up Lutheran like me, then no doubt you have heard countless sermons expressing the danger of legalism and berating those of works righteousness. Good. In fact, I gave one on Reformation Sunday this year, and you'll hear one just about every week. If you were here on Reformation Sunday, then you'll remember that I was on that elliptical machine, and even though I was huffing and puffing away, I stated that you are not saved by your good works. You are not going to heaven because you're a good person. Nor can you earn God's favor by keeping the law. However, there's also another danger, which we don't talk about much, and that is underestimating doing the good works which God has given us to do. By ignoring obedience to Christ's word, many become worthless disciples who never bear fruit. Ephesians 2, 8-10 spells it out. "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. It's a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast." That's great stuff. However, it keeps going. "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus," here it comes, "to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." There is a connection between faith and deeds, also known as good works. The issue is which comes first. Now, this is what makes Christianity unique and wonderful, because in all other religions, you have to save yourself. And I'd almost say in some Christian denominations, but well, let's get into that. But the point is, they say you have to earn it. They say you got to do something first, then you get salvation, peace, paradise, nirvana, whatever the thing is. You work first, and then you get the goods. And that makes logical sense. It does. Because that's the way it works in this world. You have a job. You work. Then they pay you. Then you get to spend the money that you earned. But that's not how it works in the kingdom of God. Just the opposite holds true. Jesus does the work. He lived perfectly, thus fulfilling all the requirements of God's law. Right? He dies a willing sacrifice on our behalf. Jesus earns salvation. Jesus paid it all. Right? He pays for it, but then we get the benefit. Then we put our faith into practice. We live it out. We put it to work. Augustine said this, it's not that we keep his commandments first and then he loves, we confessed this morning, but that he loves us first and then we keep his commandments. Think of it like this. Jesus earns the paycheck, but he puts the money in your hand. And then he tells you, now go spend it. Think of it like this. Jesus wins the Super Bowl, but then he hands you the trophy. And what do you know? Your name's inscribed on it. And then he says to you, come on, we're going to Disney World. Or think of it like this. Jesus buys a shiny brand new Corvette convertible, but he hands you the title and the keys. And he says, let's go cruising. You get it? Jesus does it. Jesus gives it. And then we put it to work and live it out. Sadly, too many Christians, too many Lutheran Christians, they get the car, but they don't put too many miles on it. They park it. It sits in the driveway, and they don't think about it much or really take care of it much. And over time, it gathers dust. It loses its luster. It rusts out and maybe even falls into disrepair. It is dangerous to have a car sit idle. Oh, maybe it's taken out couple times a year, maybe for the holidays or a special occasion, but that's about it. And for the most part, that car sits in the driveway. And at least from the neighbor's perspective, the assumption is that the car don't work. The car seems like a big waste. What good is it? They've never seen it on the road. They've never been offered a ride in it. To them, the car is dead. And it might very well be. That's what James, pardon the pun, is driving at in chapter 2. Drive the car. Go cruising. Honk the horn. James is saying good works don't earn salvation. They prove salvation. Good works don't justify, they testify. Translation, we've been given the gift of faith. We didn't earn it. No, we have been given a gift, and then we're to put the gift to work. If we choose not to put our faith into action, it is dead. It is at least non-existent to those who need our good work. Let me put it to you this way. Lots of analogies today. Let me put it to you this way by means of a scenario which was written by Kyle Eidelman, of which I am going to tweak slightly. Imagine, if you will, that Messiah Lutheran Church sends yours truly along with his family on an all-expense-paid, all-inclusive, mind you, two-week vacation to some Caribbean resort, you know, so he can kind of think about the whole call for the senior pastor position and kind of like pray about that, you know, like on the beach and stuff like, you know, not a bad idea, you know. Anyway, we have this young married couple at Messiah, and they agree to house it for the Schlieff family. And before they, you know, we leave, I give them a notebook. You know, it's filled with about 10, 12 pages of fairly detailed instructions for taking care of the house and the pets and so on. I tell them, water the plants. I write out where to find the pet food and how much to give the cat and the two dogs and the bearded dragon and the fish. I remind them to get the mail, I explained to them that trash day for us is early Friday morning, so you better put the cans out the night before. I inform them that the downstairs toilet overflows, and I clearly state where the shutoff valve is just in case. And when I give them the notebook, the couple commit to doing what it says. Now, I want you to imagine that when we come back home, all the plants are dead. The garage is just full of trash. The toilet has been overflowing for days now, and the basement is flooded. I look in the backyard, and there's this little gravesite set up where all the pets have been buried, which ain't all bad. That's not the worst part of this. That's all bad. But here's the crazy thing. Here's the crazy part of it. The couple who have been house-sitting for us explain how helpful the notebook was. In fact, they memorized certain sections of it. And I can see where they highlighted different areas. They inform me that they went over the notebook every night before going to bed together. And they even got together with a group of friends for a notebook study. And they all talked about it. You get it? Yeah, that, you know, spoken words of commitment, but there's no evidence. Did it really do anything? Those words mean anything? What good is it, James says, if you claim to have faith but you don't have deeds? Our actions should line up with our lips, what we confess. Our faith is more than just head knowledge, although head knowledge is super important. It really is. You gotta know what it is. You need to know about Jesus and about your Bible and about doctrine, what it is you believe. Because the world is, man, they're pushing back on you. Especially, man, you college kids, you high school kids, you gotta know what it is you're talking about because the world's coming after you. And they're saying that stuff, nah. Oh, man, but I'll tell you what, the more you know, the more you can feel confident and you can push back real easy. So that head knowledge is really important, but I'll tell you, James says, even the demons know about that stuff. The Christian life is more than just head knowledge. It is heart, too. It is relational. It is relational. It's not just stalking Jesus and knowing a lot of cool facts about Jesus. It's knowing Jesus. It's knowing him, and that means spending time with him. Now, throughout your day in prayer, calling on him. It's being in his word. Not as an intellectual exercise, but just as talk to me, you know? Kind of a thing. It's an intentional time with him. So our faith involves our head, it certainly involves our heart, and it involves our hands, our feet, our lips. Why is this important for us? Or to put it another way, if we're already saved by God's grace, then why should we do good works? Well, first, maybe let's just touch on what are good works. Good works are everything that God would have us to do. That covers a lot. All right, good works, it's Ten Commandments stuff. So that's why head knowledge is important, because if you don't know the Ten Commandments, how do you know? Exodus chapter 20. Ten Commandments kind of stuff. Love God, love everybody else stuff. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. You know, worship God. And it's worship God every week. See, that's a good work. May not feel like work, but that's good work. I'll give him the first and best part of your offering. Make a generous part of it. That's a good work. And I'm going to touch on this important point. Your offering is important. It's important to his church. God doesn't need your money, but your church sure does. Okay? Your gift to God is how we get the gospel delivered. We send that gospel out every day in our school. The gospel is how we care for the less fortunate. And let me just say, wow, we have so much more good work to do. We really do. In St. Charles and throughout the world, oh, wow, the harvest is ripe. And you know what? We don't sit on a big pile of money here. We get it. We spend it. We go. We do. And it's not a stewardship sermon per se, but good work definitely in your money. Our stewardship is definitely a part of good works. And this probably doesn't fit in the sermon, my head elder told me, but I'm going to say it anyway. Because I'm going to just say it as an aside, and I just want to say electronic giving is really important for your church, okay? Because we had 2 ice days, and they just fell on Sundays, and we had Christmas fall on a Sunday. You know, when our budget, when we're like, just like everybody else, week to week, you know, as an organization. So it really, really helps. And if I'm going to just ask, all right, will you consider it? Will you consider it? We do it in our house. I would still say use your envelope so your kids can see you giving. That's important. But I would say it's a blessing to your church, and I think it will be a blessing to you too, because you can't play games once you sign on the dotted line. You might want to hold off for a few weeks, though, because I'm going to be touching about this in 3 weeks, all right? Warning, Jubilee Sunday. Warning, I'm going to be talking about it. Warning, so if you want to stay home and hide, just, you know, whatever. But I'm, you know, just like this. I get these post-it notes, you know. I'm like, that's what I do. That's what I do. It matters. Okay. Sorry, head elder. You can slap me on the wrist later. But the point is that offerings help bring people into the kingdom of God. And it's true. I'll tell you a quick story real quick. Last summer, I went to Uganda. And I told you, if you're here, I think it was Reformation Sunday, I met a Muslim man. And he was our van driver, and he wasn't eating because it was Ramadan and all that. And I, all of a sudden, I was like, ooh, he's Muslim, which then I was convicted, like, ooh, now I, you know, I got to say something. I got to try. And so I did. And we kind of had this little friendship kind of deal, just emailing back and forth over the months. And then just last week, he asked me the question that I had been hoping for. And I'm going to quote the end of the email I received. It says this, Pastor Chuck, my last words will be a question. And then it's all in caps, this question. He says, how do I get to know God, love him, and receive that in return? I did, and then Laura, you were there, and Brian in the back. I said, look at his email. And no, we did. We prayed for him right then and there. I said, come on, Lord, get him. Get him. That's the stuff, church, right? See, you're a part of that. You don't know, you don't think you're a part of that, but you're a part of that, right? Together, right? You support the church. You send, or you go, you give, you work. We do good works by doing this stuff. Loving God. Loving other people through that service. We serve God by serving others. And that's another important aside. To the volunteers around here, wow, thank you. Thank you. You help keep the church going in many and various ways, so many ways. All that in a bag of chips. Truly, you matter. You matter. You really do. We need you. You have my genuine, sincere thanks. Well done, good and faithful servants. More good works. It includes serving, of course, but it also means doing a good job at your job. You know, putting a full day's work for a full day's pay. Yeah, it's very simple like that, too. It means honoring your parents. It means taking care of your spouse and your kids. It means raising them in the faith. James will point you to taking care of the poor, feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, looking after orphans and widows in their distress, sticking up for the defenseless, putting the best construction on everything, taming this thing, this tongue. That's next week, by the way. Wow. On and on and on it goes. Good work, which is really, in God's sight, great work. But let's get back to the question, why do we do good works if we don't have to? Because you don't have to. Not for salvation. Why try to be good if you're already in? If you're already saved? Here's why. I'll give you three reasons. And I like the first reason the best, although it's probably not the best motivation, but I don't know. I guess that's how I grew up. Reason number one, here it is. Because God said so. Honestly, that's a good reason. It really is. Because he's God and I'm not. It's a fact. We honor God by doing what he tells us to do and staying away from the things he told us to stay away from. Obviously, we will never perfect this, but we try. And as we try, it is a statement saying, you are God, I am not. You are Lord, I am not. You are the master, I am the servant. You are the teacher, I'm the student. You are the leader, I'm the disciple. See? Because he said so. And that should be good enough, but I'll give you two more. Reason number two, we try and do good works out of simple thanksgiving. Quoting Luther, good works are works that flow from faith and from the joy of the heart that has come to us because we've been forgiven of our sins through Jesus Christ. A truly good work then comes from a heart that faith has warmed into walking willingly in the ways of the Lord. It's our way of loving God for what he's done for us. That's how we love him back. The motivation is love. It's thankfulness. Thirdly, we do good works because our neighbor needs them. Your neighbor needs clothes. Your neighbor needs food. Your neighbor needs to see faith being lived out. Your neighbor needs Jesus. You and I are a part of how God grows the kingdom. Your neighbor may depend upon your example to see Christ and thus be saved. Faith without works is dead to your neighbor. You don't need good works, but your neighbor sure does. Okay? Amen. And now it looks like I have 3 minutes of extra time. Let's talk about the senior pastor stuff. I've had really a long time, about 16 years on top of 6 months, really, to think it over. And believe me, I've thought it over and prayed it over and talked it over and over because it's a very big deal to me. And I will tell you, it has been a struggle, a literal back and forth kind of a thing, trying to figure out, you know, a little bit about what's good for me and my wife and family and all that. Will I end up being a jerk? And, you know, that kind of those are the kinds of thoughts that we have at home. Will you be a jerk? I don't know. You know, you can only go so much more, you know, that kind of stuff. What's best for the church is the question. And that's what we've been trying to figure out. And so I've been led, I would say, just about literally led to a decision. And basically it's time to put faith into action and to get to work. So translation, yes, I'm in. No. Thanks. Right. Yes. Cool. And I go in kind of like, I always think of like Solomon. Not that I'm wise, but he went into it going, he prayed, Lord, I'm just a little kid. I'm just a little child. And that's the way I feel. I'm like, I'm just a little kid. So I do go in like humbly, I think. A little bit of fear. But I'll tell you, a lot of excitement, too. I think that's the part. A lot of excitement. To be clear, two things. First, a word of thanks. Thanks be to God. That's what I marvel. I'm like, what am I doing up here? I really do. Man, I just, what am I doing here? So I do thank God. I think of, wow, he can use just about anybody. I'm as amazed as anybody. I also want to thank the church and school staff. It really is a joy to be a part of a team. And without the people we have in place, by the way, I couldn't do it. I would say no. I definitely would. If we did not have the people who are working in ministry, Brian's in the back, Laura's right up front, another teacher, Jan, are there, and it goes on and on and on. If those people are not there, and then I'm like, I can't. Because I don't want to do all the jobs in the church. Or can I? At least. So they're very important to me, and it was a big part of my decision. And then for everyone in front of me, I want to say thanks. I know a lot of you have been praying for us, for Mary and I, and writing me little encouragements or thoughts, you know. I really want to thank you for that. It was a big part of it. But here's the deal. This is not my church. It's not my church. It's our church. We are the church. It's not Chuck's church. It is Jesus' church. And see, I just want to be a disciple with you. And I'm going to try and learn from my mistakes. And I could tell you just about every mistake I've made in the past. And I know I got some coming in the future. And I'm going to try to learn from them. I really will. And try to max out with the most that God's given me to max out with. But I'll tell you, I'm not a CEO. And I don't want to be one. I do not want. You know what the problem is? I love our church. I love being a pastor here. I love it. And it's like, man, that's what God made me to do. And you know how much fun that is when you know God made you do something and then you get to do it? It's great. And so the risk is, why would I want to give up this love that I have for a potential risk of turning into something I don't want to be, which is a manager who runs a church? I don't want to manage a church. I don't want to run a church. I want to pastor a church. Yeah. And because we have managers and administrators, it really does allow for this to happen. So I don't go in like, you know, all cocky and all that. It's got to be a together thing. It really does. I want to continue to shepherd and lead that way and teach confirmation. But what we need, in my opinion, is more of community, more us, all right, more of us working this stuff together and trying to figure it out together. I don't really know what that means, but that's the thought in my head. It's like more opinions, more working together kind of stuff. Not just like, oh, that's Schley's job, or that's the staff's job. No, it's our job. That's point we got to turn, I think, in putting our stuff together into action, accomplishing much. I've loved the last 16 and a half years. And let me tell you, we have had two really awesome senior pastors in our 30 years here. We've really been blessed that way. It's been a nice setup as I see it. Pastor Liebeck and a handful of you started this church. And it was a really important time because the tone was set and the culture was created. And it was, we're not going to do it like everybody else does it. We're going to be different on purpose. And there's going to be a relaxedness to it. And I would say, don't take it the wrong way, but we're going to do church kind of normal. Or, you know, like, and that was really, really, really important. So that culture was created. That's chapter one in the books. And then came my dear friend, Pastor Paul. And many of you grew this church. And boy, he's so gifted with strategies and systems and building programs. And the school got off the ground and just took off. And he and Beth, man, they what an awesome job. And I miss them so much. But chapter two is over. I don't like it, but it's over. And now it's time for chapter 3. And I don't know what chapter 3 says yet. Right? That's what I'm saying. We're going to figure this thing out. What does that look like? It hasn't been written yet. But it's going to be together. We have to do it together. We cannot let not knowing keep us from getting started. It'll be by faith. Yeah. See, I'm trying to live this stuff out. I do not know where we're going. I do not know what I'm doing. Here we go. What? Everyone's like, oh, man, we're hosed. No. It'll be all right. We got a big, no, if there's more people, then there's a better chance. So. No, but the point is, we got to work. We're going to work. And I'll push you. I'm going to challenge us. I think we've been natural, on purpose, we've been sitting back for at least 6 months because we didn't know who was going to be the senior pastor. And that was totally right. Totally right. But it is time. It is time to put our faith, our lips, our thoughts, all those things into real action. And the best part of all, the best part, it's Jesus' church. That's the thing. It's his church. He's the boss. He's in charge. He loves the church more than we love the church. It's his church. He is a wonderful Savior who paid it all. All to him we owe. And he's put the keys in our hands. The tank is full. Buckle up, Messiah. Let's go cruising. I look forward to taking this ride with you. Amen.